Yes, please.
May I react to the earlier sculptural edition?
Yeah.
I saw for the first time. So you contrasted, you know, the solid and the fluid. So the liquid is observable and takes the shape of a container. And I saw your work, the initial works, the, on the pedestals, mostly, or the ones that were sort of public space or academic spaces. I saw them as containers.
The
solid. The solid are containers of nothingness, which is the liquid. And the liquid is the relationship of the viewer in the round, because they're not against the wall, and the other viewers, and the viewers of one another, and I found that very compelling.
Yeah, I would say that it is very, this taxonomy, the dry works and the liquid works, that's fine. Most of the time it's a mixed condition. But it is certain that for me, when I say dry, it is not only in terms of the form, which is relevant also the form of the content. It is in relation to the meaning that I invest. And if the meaning that I invest is very clear, it is a dried condition. If I have no idea about the meaning, I simply like it, or I like the fact to contemplate on that, because you are speaking about the ecology of attention, but I would say also that we have to write about an ecology of contemplation. I don't know to which extent
of contemplation.
I don't know to
she had me put yeah.
Yeah. To which extent this work this term is against attention, but because there is an attentive way of contemplating the things, of course. But contemplating the things doesn't mean necessarily that we understand everything in a logical apparatus, but we are seduced by something that we like to contemplate. I'm not speaking about the traditional notion of the sublime and the mountain. No? The things that happen with the world, naturally. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I just want to ask a little question. How what you just said maps on to the language you were using earlier about the low? Because typically, and maybe this is precisely your point, you know, the contemplation and jouissance don't, you know, they don't, they're high. You know? And I think you said that.
I'm trying to interpret jouissance from the instinctual way, not the relation with the sublime. I'm speaking more about the sexual pleasureness of the jouissance, and the fact that jouissance doesn't offer any meaning, it offers, it has hedonistic qualities. And hedonistic qualities in terms of the treatment of sculpture in relation to the sculpture has to do with the materiality of the world, the material condition, the textural profile of the world, and the fact that he's never there is a space in order to feel all the time viewing this object. There is no predetermined, complete explication, perspective. If, you know. So, between base materialism and jouissance, I find almost a similarity.
I was wondering whether you left the captions out of the images. No, I mean, because I know that the titles are very much part of his work. And because I've seen your works with the titles, and I know that the titles are very much part of them, I felt that they were liquefied without their captions. And I just thought that this was interesting. But I was wondering if you did it in purpose, or you just...
It is true that I didn't want to give an emphasis to the presentation of my work, so I would say that my intention was to write something, and if I have to say the title in each work, it would be...
Yeah.
Otherwise, if there is any poetical aspect, it's better through silence to understand that. I mean, It is different to see the tide, to write, to read the tide, and to find your personal time in order to understand that, than to say the tide with you in a book. It's like an advertisement.
I mean, no, especially when it comes to your work, I don't think it's advertising it at all.
Yes, I don't, but I would prefer someone to read the tag visually, not to...
Yeah, I mean, it could be written, but...
It is not a poetic act in the sense of the work of Phoebe Danisi. Mm. That's necessary to have an oral experience with her poetry. Mm. It's something else.
I was interested in the way your works with photographs. Do you think a lot about that? Because in terms of shadow and
speak about these.
I was thinking about this. Yeah. I was also thinking about the work that you showed, the long red. This one here.
Yeah, yeah.
In terms of the cut of the shadow and the cut of the, and then when you moved to the liquid works, mm-hmm. you were. There was a kind of mottled sunshine. Mm-hmm. There was an element of which you couldn't really kind of interpret mm-hmm. what was part of the work, what was a back. You know, there was something about that photograph where actually, if I could just continue on this, in the dry works, shadow cuts, in the liquid works, shadow kind of porous things. But I don't know really.
But I did have dissipation. I did.
That's
I think I have the relation to have to be creative photography.
Yeah.
Big photography has a function as an archive for me in order to be understandable anything that I'm doing with sculpture, because it has this it promises the concept of reality photography more than any other medium, so I'm using it as
You are taking photographs of what you do.
What?
You are taking photographs
yes.
or some that somebody else do now.
It depends. If I would go to the studio, I would take the photograph. I don't have my personal photographer to come. I'm not Jeff Koons, of course.
Fortunately.
Thank God.
Never stop to David Smith.
David Smith, okay, I would prefer to be David Smith.
David Smith's photography of his own stuff.
Ah, yes, okay. Yes, yeah,
sure.
That's what I'm thinking about.
Yes, of course, there's a tradition. Even Brancusi was sponsored, not only.
So even if you didn't take it, it's yours.
I would take photographs because nobody else would do that.
Your first work is photographs.
Yes.
In the beginning of your career as an artist.
Yeah, yeah.
You remember?
Yes, but okay, there were photographs of objects.
Photographs.
Yeah.
Let's put forgetting on the board.
There you go. Yeah. But do you think you were describing it? I think you were describing a kind of your own poetics during the manufacture of the sculptures. The liquidity and the solidity, let's say, I had this impression, had to do with your own jouissance from the one part and or not, and from the jouissance who didn't give as a result a very stable meaning according to you. That was the
exactly what I had discussed with Constance before in
mm-hmm.
the break.
Mm-hmm.
About the effect of Pinocchio. I feel like a Geppetto
mm-hmm.
that is doing his own stuff.
Mm-hmm.
He's quite okay.
Mm-hmm.
He thinks that he will have a final secure result,
mm-hmm.
but the same result is against the first ideas and mm-hmm. provide something else. Mm-hmm. So it has this transformative character. Mm-hmm. The final work mm-hmm. to be something most of the times very different than your initial plan. It is for all of us. How do we stop
yeah.
that?
It's a very well,
yes, mm-hmm. yes. It is almost metaphysical mm-hmm. issue because we can stop it in the beginning, in the middle, whatever. Mm-hmm. Why will we feel that the effect of Pinocchio took place? I mean, the effect of Pinocchio in terms that Geppetto was planning to make a marionette in order to gain some money in mm-hmm. the streets, but finally became his own child. Mm-hmm. When you will feel that it's a child, I mean, it is something unexpected, mm-hmm. so it is the time to mm-hmm. to leave it mm-hmm. as it is.
This goes back to what we started with this morning, I guess, with Joy's point about how do you impose form, even if it's for a temporary purpose.
Yeah.
I mean, when do you know that enough is enough for this present purpose? Mm. So it's to think of form as something you impose momentarily, rather than in an exclusionary sense of yeah. erecting more permanent boundaries.
Yeah.
That is, of course, the discourse of the seduction, or yeah. why I was assisting. It's not that these work are seductive. They are seductive in order to understand for what reason in the process we sometimes we leave it as mm-hmm. but
in a similar vein, how would you characterize your affective orientation to scavenging the material?
Because it is a part of this reality. I don't say that we have typical most of my objects, until recently, because of the crisis, it's even ready to fight the civilist wood mm-hmm. because they are using it only for the fire. Mm-hmm. People that don't have the possibility to have electricity fire. But until recently, it was my main activity. I was scavenging in the suburbs. And I was, because I'm living in an area that there are a lot of marble shops, old wood shops, mm-hmm. and sometimes from the remnants, I take my stuff and I'm doing my constructions. So it has something with the process of scavenging. Also, digging in the soil, I discover things that I'm using in my stuff. It is not too far away from the practice of an archaeologist. Mm-hmm. That he has not a clear idea what he will find, but he finds something that he thinks it is interesting for his research.
It is also close to bricolage techniques.
Of course, it is also, because from the facts you will try to that you have a certain material, and you should find a solution with this material. So it is a bricolage, because you don't know before what you will order in order to be ready, which is the point of view of a mechanic. If I want to follow Claude Lévi-Strauss.
So first you collect and then you have ready.
Yeah, yeah. Not all the times, to be sincere, not all the times, but even if I have to plan to know what I need from the wood shop or the carpenter, the carpentry, I will add some new elements that
I was reminded of something that Brooke said in her interview with us, Fisher, about did you ask him, do you think intelligent inheres in material?
Yeah, there's a whole discussion about the hand, actually.
But then he goes, well, the hand, which was kind of weird, because it was I think you were saying something about, I was thinking you were thinking about Pygmalion or something.
Well, there's something kind of to do with
the material makes me work. The material makes me do something. So I was just brought to that by the fact that you said mm-hmm. you find a solution to the question that the material poses for you. But yeah, sorry, Dan.
Yeah.
Well, there's this interesting idea of when an artist encounters an object from the past, and we were talking about, I believe, we're talking about artworks from the past? And
okay.
Like, is there kind of, like, how does an artist relate to artworks differently from the historian or the critic? And, like, is there an intelligence that inheres in the work? And it was this oscillation between thinking of the kind of animism of the material as being personal, but then the introduction of the hand is like a kind of trace of intentionality that, like, an artist recognizes in another artist, but is nevertheless preserved by the materiality, so that there's always a kind of complicity between the artist's intention and the material, that there's not an easy subject-object relationship, but, like, what the artist makes is already sort of already given by what the material is. And so that, I think that's a kind of nice way of kind of dealing with the way that you don't have to cut between the animism of the matter or the intention or the hand of the artist, but the fact that the creative act is already some negotiation with what is given.
Yeah.
Is there.
Okay, this remark about the animism of the object, I think it has a ritual and...
And the hand, I just want to hear something earlier about the hand in a political context, like,
yeah,
but,
yeah,
whether,
yeah,
like, this notion of the hand.
I think it is, most of the time, it is a post-studio practice, in terms that, okay, there is kind of, I can explain that there is metaphysics about the animicity of the object, but I think it is that. The only reason why I'm concerned more with sculpture than any other medium is that because I have this naive intention to believe that it is more near to reality. So it is a sculpture that provokes, it has the intention of a kind of functionality, in terms that it has aspects from architecture and the world of design. So it is beyond to the metaphysics of the same object per se, following these relations in between the gesture of the creator and the animist of the object. It's something else.
Yeah.
But of course it has also, it is an opera aperta condition. Opera aperta, as Umberto Eco says, mm-hmm, for the l'espace de l'œuvre ouvert.
Yes.
And it has,
in German.
You would be very unlikely to say that in German.
So important. You're on the last panel. Everybody gets jingling.
Okay. It's like your obsession with the popular sculptures and the known sculptures and all these things. For you, is a type of bas antiquity, bas classic.
Yeah, look, it's proletarian.
Because you have strong interest with popular unknown sculptures.
Yeah. I don't have a specific knowledge on that.
But you have
I know more David Smith.
Some publications, some references in your text.
Yes.
Okay. Existence.
Folklore sculpture, because, yes. I think because it has an anthropological value that I find more interesting than the classic derivation of sculpture, and of course the classical essence sculpture, which is, I would say, I'm from the opposite side on that matter. That is the reason why, for me, the archetypical model is the amphitheater, not the kouros. Okay, it is an archive model. But I don't say that amphitheater in terms of a very neat and political aspect, in terms of design and architecture and the functionality of the space and the issues that concerns the social and at the same time private reality of the human being.
Do you know much about the wooden, sorry, wooden
structures?
No,
we have one more question because then I think we're going to wrap up.
Wooden structures in Rome, before any amphitheatre there, the crowds are in wooden structures along the route of the triangle. Mm-hmm. So there'd be wooden platforms rather than, they only had temporary theatres for a long time in Republican Rome, and they then built, so we think of Rome as like the Colosseum or like big amphitheatre, but actually there was at the time when wooden construction was very important.
No, I don't have a clear idea about that. Yeah. I don't have any images to follow, but I would love to have more information.
Yeah.
Because I know that the Romans made reality the architectural scale. You know?
Yes.
Right.
Sorry,
we could continue, but I don't have to run, but I wonder if we might just pause and come back, because we'll have time tomorrow.
Take a breath.
Yeah.
I can probably give a bit kind of giggly, it's like
time for dinner.
It's like we reach some point, it's pause, and then we might crash.
So what's
the plan for dinner?
The dinner is next year.
The restaurant. And it seemed very complete.
No, I don't mean it.
No, I don't really, but
that's fine. Oh, yeah.
Can I ask a question? Another question for the schedule. Who would like to go to visit tomorrow after lunch, the Dagestan collection? Because if... Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay. So, we will tell you exactly the time. Maybe you can take two taxis.
That's social distance. It starts at this time. So it's live.
But if you go to Germany,
States
will you?
They don't always do this.
So
this is live from Passau, right? They don't have to look at the script. Doesn't really tell you anything. Well, I'll talk to you about the script.
Yeah.
After the session on the
Q.